Hello, everyone. Hello. There we go. So before I get started, hey everyone, I hope you are having an amazing time and enjoying Oslo. Before I really dig into this, I'm wondering really quickly why the screen isn't showing my presentation at the bottom, but I'd like everyone to go to this link just in case you'd like to get involved with the work. There we go, later on. It is www.bitnation.co, not.com, but.co/presale. We are building a virtual nation on a blockchain jurisdiction. And since we just heard a talk about toilets, I'd like to mention someone else who's absolutely full of, or actually, you know what? Let's not even go there. But let's talk about some other people. Let's talk about some leaders, philosophers, or philosophy thought leaders, and the men who have structured the evolution of Western thought. This is Aristotle, Edward Bernays, Sigmund Freud, and Keynes, and they are responsible for the creation and destruction of what we now see as our current environment for democracy, at least in the United States. Now, while Aristotle is the founder of democracy, in and of himself, he didn't believe the system was perfect. In fact, Aristotle actually predicted that something like Donald Trump would happen and founded his theory. In addition to that, that theory has come to a falling point because of men like Edward Bernays, who is actually the nephew of Sigmund Freud, who built his theories on propagating this idea of Keynesian economics through the manipulation of people's unconscious minds. We now live in a world where in our Western idea of American democracy, you have more power voting with your credit card than you do in a national election, as the Electoral College makes the executive decision on who the president will be, as we've seen from our last election. In addition to that, free markets do not mean free people. And people who are voting with their credit cards are largely making their decisions, compensating for deficiencies they have been made to believe they had through manipulating their unconscious mind with propaganda, or as Bernays likes to call it, public relations. Now, there are a lot of words like public relations and concepts like democracy that we think mean one thing in theory, but in practice actually create something totally different. Like this. This is the world, right? This is how it looks. Actually, it really looks a little bit more like this. And it used to look a lot like this. Now, if you'll notice, on all of these images, you'll see lines and borders. Things that are meant to separate us as a humanity, when really, we are all just one human race. We have borders and essentially the oligopolistic structure of the nation state because of the peace treaty, the Peace of Westphalia, which changed our governance model from city-states into top-down hierarchical structures of nations, changing population densities to sizes which at times can seem unreasonable and unmanageable for one person to have centralized control and authority over. But fundamentally, we are not defined by our borders. We are defined by our people. And in the way the current system works, we have taken that power out of the hands of the people and put the power into the hands of a system, dehumanizing oftentimes populations, where over 50% of the world lives under an oppressive regime or a dictatorship. Now, when I hear people talk about GovTech, 98% of the time, every person that I speak with talks about funding a faster horse. But we do not need to strap a rocket ship to a mule to create long-term sustainable change in government. In fact, investing in solutions building on top of the current infrastructure is only more costly and more time inhibitive. For example, the website for food stamps in California, which looks like it was actually built in Windows 98, cost $300 million to build. We're spending $300 million to build a website that has less than a 50% rate of success for people who are actually applying for those benefits, when we could be using that money to, I don't know, feed hungry people or perhaps build homes for homeless people, which San Francisco has 6 times more homeless people than Bangkok. That is a real number, oh my gosh. So instead of funding faster horses built to propagate inefficient systems of infrastructure, we have a car. And if you'd like to come along on the ride, you can get in. I will open the door. BitNation is the world's first virtual nation. We universalize access to rights with blockchain technology, empowering systems of self-sovereign identity, and at the end of the day, competitive marketplaces for governments. Because really, governments should be competing for your citizenship, not telling someone who is essentially a Holocaust survivor that they should wait until 2020 to perhaps be considered to have some form of existence in the world today. Now, if Bitcoin is to blockchain as email is to the internet, BitNation is to government as the internet is to cable TV. We are fundamentally borderless, voluntary, and decentralized. We don't care where you're from or where you live or how many governments you want to belong to, how many governments you might even want to create. We operate on a cryptographically secured public ledger called the blockchain, the BitNation blockchain, and we're fundamentally a completely open source movement dedicated to providing access to rights to people around the world. So instead of being forced to participate in a nation, we invite people to code their own nation. Now, we provide a lot of different functions. Essentially, BitNation replaces the plus one, the itpa, sorry for my French, of the, I am American, I'm sorry, of the nation state, which is jurisdiction. Because the only way we are going to redefine government from the bottom up and the top down is if we disrupt its very reason for being. So we provide several different functions on our platform, vetting your counterparts, choosing your code of law, your witness, your arbitrators, escrow, dispute resolution, the creation, generation, notarization of contracts, and the resolution of disputes. But instead of talking really big and esoterically about all the cool things that you can do, I'd rather tell you guys about what we've actually done. Because I generally work with activists, I don't believe thoughts are powerful things, because you cannot kill a thought, you cannot destroy an idea. But when you actually take an idea and put it into action, that is when you make impact, and that at the end of the day is the only thing that I care about. So we have created the World Citizenship ID. It is essentially a proof of existence that's as simple as making a Facebook account that is registered on a public blockchain accessible to any person in the world who would like to view it, that says, I, as this person, whether or not I link my social media accounts, have this name, and I exist, I am here, and I am now. We are working on international acceptance for many different organizations, and in fact, just won the UNESCO Grand Prix for our work with one of the most important groups of populations who needs access to world citizenship, refugees. Because I believe refugees should be able to travel between borders as frictionlessly as someone can send a money like Bitcoin peer-to-peer. Now, what this means is any refugee across the world may not necessarily need to, at the end of the day, belong to a nation state to have the right to exist. In addition to our services for refugees, we also provide them with, in addition to identity, the ability to have a form of financial freedom and build a reputation that could lead to them having an effective credit history, another factor that can increase their ability to gain admittance to a nation should they so choose to align with one, and that is through our Bitcoin Visa debit card. Because while refugees are Holocaust survivors who are in many instances being denied admittance to nation and denied the ability to have a job, even though over time we have shown that allowing immigrants in may increase joblessness initially, but at the end of the day will actually increase the value of your economy and create more jobs, These refugees have the ability to build a digital credit history while simultaneously working digital jobs, earning Bitcoin for the work that they build, paying different bills, and having an immutable record of that is also linked to their identity, information that all nation states, not just one nation state, would be very interested in having. In addition to our finance, we solve another problem that no one talks about with refugees, which is social inclusion. I've often said that maybe if we just got all of these people that were fighting in one room together and like threw a party for them, things would just work out. And so we've essentially created what is Airbnb for refugees through our embassy network, which means that any person in the world can register their home and open up their home if they have extra space, allow a refugee or any nation citizen to stay with them for a period of time, whether that's a week, a month, a day, or a year, and create a series of open source guidelines for these people to understand what it means to participate socially in a country, because there are many questions and many things that seem very obvious to us that refugees have no idea, like, do I need to pay to ride the bus? Is the food that's wrapped in plastic contaminated, or is that okay to eat? And we, through our embassy network, anyone can sign up for home. It's just as easy as linking your home to Airbnb, if not simpler. And you are the person who gets to decide how long someone is able to stay with you. Because at the end of the day, if nations are not going to solve this problem from the top down, I know so many humanitarian individuals who, if given the power to take matters into their own hands, would truly do amazing world-changing things for this planet. Now, we're also working with a few governments. So for example, we do the e-residency, the e-Estonia program, using blockchain technology, and are really happy to be working with them. They're an incredibly progressive nation in terms of technology, and they're very interestingly politically positioned to be progressive on this front. Now, in addition to our partnerships with governments and our programs for refugees, we've also created something called Smart Love. There are 65.3 million stateless people recorded on this planet, and this is still, hearing this number absolutely shocks me every time I hear it. Only 23 nations in the world allow LGBTQ marriage. That's 12% of nations. In 15 nations or more, it is actually legal to kill someone for being gay under certain record of law. I still can't even process that every time I say it. Now, this is one of my really good friends. Her name is Asha Jacqueline, and she's arguably one of the largest LGBTQ activists in the world. She lives in Uganda, where they attempted to pass the Kill All the Gays bill, giving people the death penalty for being gay, and have since passed an anti-homosexuality law, giving people life in prison for being LGBTQ. So Smart Love provides LGBTQ couples with the ability to get anonymously married on the blockchain, keeping their identity completely private while pseudo-anonymously opening them up to receive peer-to-peer donations from rights organizations who may want to anonymously fund these individuals to have a healthier, better, and more productive life. So the future is borderless and governed digitally. In addition to everything that I just mentioned, you'll see a little land title. We also recorded the first land titles ever on the blockchain in Ghana. The future of government is not the system that has existed, and it's up to all of us to take agency into our hands as self-actualized individuals and change the way the world works today, and I will try and give you the power to do that with everything I have. Now, you may think, how does this actually work? I've had investors speak to me and say, well, we want you to charge refugees a dollar to register their identity to be profitable. And I say, listen, let me actually tell you how my business works. I'm not going to charge that refugee, and I'm going to give that information to governments for free, and I'm actually going to give the refugee money. And here's how that's possible. Blockchain business models take traditional business models of technology and absolutely flip them on their head, i.e. the traditional model is, I am a user, you provide me with a service, I get that service for free, and I give you data, you sell that data to enterprise organizations who may want to use that client to sell you ads and beyond. But blockchain actually works by saying, you own your own data, and if someone wants to query you for your information personally, they're going to have to enter a paywall to to get that information from you. And even if we wanted to sell that data, fundamentally we couldn't because it's public. We are in a transition with blockchain from capitalism to protocolism, which means every person who is a user in the company is not selling themselves to get a service for free. They are actively shareholders in the venture that they are participating in and contributing data towards. And actually, the people who are going to contribute the most amount of information to BitNation are those who are not provided with services from traditional nation states. The higher the transaction volume on a blockchain token with a finite supply of resources, i.e. we're launching 100 million tokens, the more people register their land, the more people create jurisdiction and arbitration functions. That token is scarce and the value of that is going to go up. It's very simple supply and demand economics, and we are launching a BitNation token within the next couple of months, which is why I told you to go to bitnation.co/presale at the beginning of this talk. Our goal is to create global solidarity through technology, because revolution does not always need to mean violence. It can mean peaceful evolution through creation-based societies and the ubiquitous distribution of rights using new technologies. This is the link one more time, just in case you want to check things out. And this is my personal information. Thank you all so much. And I'd like to leave you with, well, you say you want a revolution. Well, you know, we all want to change the world. You can take matters into your own hands. Thank you so much.